Remember when your biggest stress was what game to play at recess? Today's artists are going back to a simpler time as they dive into childhood memories for their inspiration.
The Cutout Memories is about objects that have resonated with me in my youth, and that's why nostalgia means a lot to me.
When Sister I came, honey, it was time for Jully Black to soar.
Hello and welcome to CBC Arts Exhibitionists, the show that gives you a 30-minute inside peek into the innovative and imaginative world of Canadian art. I'm your host, Amanda Paris. We're living in a moment where people are obsessed with nostalgia. From 90s fashion to 90s TV shows, it seems like people just want to go back in time. And that's what this week's artists are doing. Remembering is comforting, because looking into the future can be scary. Not knowing what's going to happen next, it's the perfect recipe for anxiety. That's why our first artist, Nico Glaude, finds his safe and most creative place in the past.
My name's Nico Glaude. I'm a Sudbury-based installation artist, curator, and raconteur. I've been obsessed with the idea of public art for well over a decade now. Just the idea of making art that you can let go of yourself as an artist and make it for the public, it becomes theirs. The Cutout Memories is about objects that have resonated with me in my youth, and that's why nostalgia means a lot to me. So it's these little objects that I recreate and expand on, literally in terms of size and figuratively in terms of rediscovering these memories.
All the installations are made out of literally just cardboard, duct tape, and acrylic paint. There's nothing more to it. I've been hinting or exploring a lot of nostalgia recently because it is a place where I feel comfortable in and don't feel anxious. And I can sit in that moment and actually be happy while I create these installations.
The reasons why the objects are so big is because it adds a sense of absurdity to everything.
Like right away, you can tell there's something off. Like, why is this giant blockbuster box here? Or this giant dull banana box? It creates a sense of curiosity right away. You're familiar with the object, but you're not familiar why the object is so big. And therefore, it becomes an installation, it becomes a sculpture, it becomes public art, because you're at an element of what's going on here. And then it makes hopefully the viewer ask a few questions of why is this so big? How did they build it? Why is it here? My first job ever was washing dishes at like this breakfast restaurant in town, and I was 14. And I remember every time I'd go take out the trash, there was a bunch of giant Dole banana boxes. But I remember seeing the Dole box and seeing this banana on a skateboard. And like, I never skateboarded when I was a kid. I've always wanted to. And it was almost like, if a banana can do it, like, why can't I do it? It always like stuck with me. So it literally wasn't until a few weeks ago, walking in the alleyways and seeing the Dole box and like remembering when I was 14 and being pissed at this banana that can skateboard, and I couldn't do it. For me, that's why I did this box, was literally being pissed off at a banana. I can only hope that people see it and they have that emotional connection or that sense of nostalgia like I do. If they can just take that, you know, 30 seconds or a minute to look back on a moment and feel something about it, I think I did my job.
Throughout this episode, in between each of our stories, you're gonna see some really captivating digital art. It was all created by our exhibitionist in residence, an artist whose work we've chosen to showcase this week. I'd like you to meet Carson Teal.
I work with animation, sculpture, installation, sound, and video art. I'm your exhibitionist in residence this week. I use different material and objects, whether it's physical or digital, to create my work. I try to find meaning and memory in these objects, and I view them as having different forms of expression to create an environment that gives the audience a new experience of their reality. You are about to see a series of GIF animations, and you can follow me on Instagram or check out my website to see more of my work.
Thank you. We're staying in the digital world for this next piece. We teamed up with CBC Radio and animators across the country to bring some of our favorite radio clips to life. This clip is animated by Shweta Sansgiri in her throwback 8-bit style. Basically, a guy tells a story from his childhood about his dog's butt and the sneaky antics of his big brother. Check it out.
When I was a kid, our family dog was a dachshund named Roby. My brother was in fifth grade, and I was in kindergarten, and we were home because it was a snow day, and I went downstairs, and my brother was talking to the dog on the couch, and I didn't know what he was doing. He was blowing in the dog's ear, and the dog was shaking his head. And I said, what are you doing, Steve? And he said, I'm talking to the dog. And I said, well, what are you asking the dog? And he said, I'm asking Roby if he loves me. And I said, well, what did he say? He said, well, he says he loves me. So I kind of let that sink in for a minute, and then, of course, I was hooked. And I said, gee, Steve, could you ask Roby if he loves me? He said, sure. And he did, and then he said, oh, no, Roby. And I said, well, what'd he say? He says, oh, I can't tell you. And I said, no, tell me. And he said, well, he said he doesn't love you, Lee. And I said, oh, and I was crushed. And I said, well, what do I have to do? Ask him if there's anything I can do. And so he whispered some more, and then he said, no, to the dog. And I said, well, what'd he say? He said, I can't tell you. It's not okay. And I said, tell me. And he said, okay. He says, if you kiss him on his ass, he will love you forever. And I said, okay. That was a no-brainer for me. I mean, one moment of that act to a forever of undying and forever love. So I went over and I proceeded to do exactly what Roby said would be required for him to love me. And my mother came down the stairs precisely at that moment.
Coming up, we meet an artist fascinated by sheep's wool and bedtime stories. When Eszter Burghardt was a child, her mother told her stories about creatures in the woods. Those tales haunted and fascinated her. Now, as a mother herself, Eszter has taken those stories and transformed them into something even more magical for her own children.
When I was a little girl, I spent a lot of time along the Danube River, and it's surrounded by a really dark forest full of all sorts of wildlife. And my mom would always warn me about this group of wild boars. And that feeling, that sensation of going through the dark forest and these animals in the woods watching us has always stayed with me. I began working with wool in 2009 after I went on a residency in Iceland. And I really went there to be inspired by the landscape. And since I was a painter, I expected to come back with these images to paint. And I was really surprised to see all the sheep in every single corner of the landscape. And that really inspired me to begin really using wool. I began using local Icelandic wool because a lot of work I've been doing has been local. And the sheep farm I've been going to for years, they breed Icelandic sheep, so that kind of ties back to the beginning of me working with wool. And I also love using Icelandic fleece as well. It's amazing. It's very raw and it's very sculptural and very natural, and it really suits the coastal weather, and I think it relates really nicely in the sculptures. It really shows the sort of like the wear and tear of the land and landscape, the elements. So my current work is called Esti Meshe, Sculptures from a Bedtime Story. And Esti Meshe in Hungarian means bedtime stories. And this is about a tale of animals from a childhood, from a deep, dark European forest in the Danube River, where I pretty much grew up, and how they migrate from Hungary and they meet the wildlife of the Canadian wilderness. And this is a story about my childhood and my kids' childhood, and basically I'm telling them a tale of our history. Hey, Hedgehog, come on board. Quick, 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 boat's leaving. Go, 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 go. There we go. Big waves. I can't swim, guys. You know, me being a mother and my constant fascination with kids' imaginations and my imagination. I still remember a lot of things I imagined as a little kid. And just really, really cool watching them kind of around that same age that I would have been really influenced by all this stuff. It's just important for me to make work that I can sort of dedicate to them, but I'm also very inspired by my kids as well. Yeah, so it's like the perfect way to tell them a story, and I can dedicate it to them.
Jully Black has been named one of the 25 greatest Canadian singers ever and is known as Canada's Queen of Soul. She's also a fave on my R&B radio show, Marvin's Room. We had the opportunity to ask Jully about the movie that changed her life, and her response is divine.
When Sister I came, honey, it was time for Jully Black to soar. Let me take you back to being 6 years old at the Dundas Street Church of God. One day I asked if I could sing with them. And I remember them bringing me up, closing my eyes, took a deep breaths, and I just said, "Oh, it is Jesus. Yes, it is Jesus. It is Jesus in my soul." And I remember everyone started to cry and lift their hands and worship. And in that moment, my life was forever changed. I saw Whoopi in so many movies growing up, and then in Sister Act with Lauryn Hill being a part of the movie, and a young Lauryn Hill. So I heard her voice. I didn't know that was the Lauryn Hill she was going to become.
Joyful, joyful Lord, we adore thee.
To hear that voice, that alto, that reminded me of myself, because there's a time growing up where if you didn't sing as high as Mariah or as high as Whitney, you know, it was like, oh, hi, how high can you sing?
He taught me how.
Once I was able to sing in church and recognize that people felt something off of my voice and my family supported me in doing that, it was amazing to now see Sister Act 2. It's almost like I, you know, kind of manifested that movie or something. And to recognize the power of community, like those children were brought together, you know, through music. That's really saved my life, to be honest with you, with being someone raised in the inner city. Music and being in choir and being in church and being a part of something that kept my imagination like really bright and vibrant. That Sister Act 2 movie really, really did that for me.
Jully was one of the panelists during this year's annual book competition, Canada Reads. And although the book she was defending didn't win the competition, she delivered a sermon that made sure she won the cultural moment. Here's the clip that went viral.
Jully had said, "We don't have to be our past, but we have the power to rewrite the future." So how does your book address this? I'd like Jeannie to weigh on that first.
Well, again, so much in the Marylthes was about the importance of storytelling and remembering the stories and really learning from the elders and learning about the way it was. That's exactly the premise of this book. It's all about the intergenerational dialogue and trying to learn from our past in order to move forward. I mean, always, you know, with an eye on the past, of course, but not getting hung up on it in order to reinvent and reimagine and really move forward in brave, new, wondrous ways.
There's healing, then there's action with the healing. And that's the thing. I you know, it's important for us to really look at what book is going to have Canada open their eyes to what is happening on today. And yes, we celebrate and we heal and we kumbaya and we light.
But you look at what's happening with ourselves. I mean, this is
a good.
Yeah, we've
got to
change the world. But people are really, there are a lot of like screwed up people in the world.
There's a lot of colonial privilege.
There's a lot of people that really
need. This room excluded, of course. This studio excluded.
Yeah,
there's a lot of people that have to work on themselves. I mean, when we
there's a lot of people who sit in their cottages in their homes and don't have an experience like others and think that it's, well, you know what, let me swipe my Visa card and make a donation, but I don't live this experience. What are we doing to change the current circumstances? We just had a Pope say he's not saying I'm sorry to Indigenous Canadians when he said that in 2015. It is happening right now.
I'm not saying
it's got to change. Yes, we forgive. I believe in Jesus.
But why are you attacking me, Jully? Why are you attacking me? No, I totally get what you're saying, and I have.
Hold on, we're live right now. Why are you attacking me?
I'm not attacking you.
The truth hurts. I didn't say anything to attack you, Jeannie Becker. I said nothing about Jeannie Becker.
No, I'm just saying you're.
Did I feel say anything about Jeannie Becker?
I just feel that you're speaking to me like I don't believe that. I totally get what you're saying.
Let me tell you what you just said. I feel like. So whatever you're feeling, take it to the altar, because I'm not the one that's responsible for your feelings.
Coming up, we'll meet the young creators behind a new kind of comic book. Welcome back. Traditionally, comic books are about superheroes who save the world. But for this group of young Asian artists, comic books are a place to tell their stories of growing up. They're smaller stories, but they're just as brave. Our correspondent, April Aliermo, is taking us to a workshop to meet some of these young creators.
There are many ways in which newcomer and second-generation Canadians find community here. Some do it through school, others through cultural associations, and some through their settlement workers. But who have ever thought to build and develop community through comic book making? How can such an isolating and personal craft facilitate community? We're about to get insight into a comic book making program made for Asian youth.
And I started this program called Comic Making Workshop Residency Program for Asian youth. When I first started doing comics, I wasn't seeing a lot of Asian voices. What's really interesting about the youth voices in this workshop is that they have a wide range of life path, and that's sort of like what I wanted to kind of explore. That there is diversity in Asian voices, and that's not necessarily talked about.
I think it's very powerful to see yourself represented in media of any sort, and I don't think that's something I realized until fairly recently. Like, I read a lot of books by white men, and I was like, oh my gosh, they're so emotional. I totally identify with them. And then you get older, and you're like, oh my gosh, I have nothing in common with these people. And then you watch TV, or you read like poems or short stories that are by people who are more like you, and suddenly you're like, this is so much more moving. This actually is representative of my experience.
The feeling that you get it out from your chest, I mean, a vast memory. Like, I want to talk about how I arrived in Canada. I feel proud a little bit and very happy. Like, I'd never done this before in my entire life.
Yeah.
It's not that kind of pride. It's more like a happiness that I never had before. So.
Aww. Manifestations of love in immigrant families sometimes look really, really different than white families. But I think it just presents itself really differently, and that's something I'm trying to illustrate in the comic. Not like explicit proclamations of I love you, but what little things people do. It was like with my grandfather, I don't think we ever told each other that we loved each other, even though it was assumed. And yeah, I have a page in my comic that's around how I used to I make us tea eggs, but like he passed away, so I never eat them anymore. It's like this like really long process. And I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't even know it took that long to make. And he like every time he visited, he would make them. So just stuff like that where it's like obviously like an I'm gonna cry.
The word fat in the Philippines kind of like feels like you're out of space, like in a country where everything is cramped, sizes are made small, like people are small. I feel like I've always been like an outsider in terms of like relating to people. So like my zine is about working through that. The comic helped me because I think it's one step towards adulthood too, to process the pain that I felt when I was a kid, to become like more whole in a sense. Mostly it's about making peace with myself as well.
It's been really, really nice to have like a space to talk about things that we share in common, and just hearing what everyone's different comics are about has been like really amazing and like very moving.
If there's an artist you think should be on CBC Arts Exhibitionists, let us know. Send us a message on Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook. Our handle is @CBCArts. I'll be back next time with even more artists from Baker Lake to Niagara-on-the-Lake. Until then, keep creating and innovating. But before I go, I'm gonna leave you with a time-lapse video of a still-life painting by Megan Ellen McDonald. You'll wanna eat it. Peace.